Welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. My guest today, Elizabeth L. Silver, has written one of the most extraordinary books I've read this year. It is a book that book clubs all over America will be discussing later on this month or next month. The book is called The Execution of Noah P. Singleton. It's published by Crown Publishers. Welcome, Elizabeth.
Thank you so much for having me.
And it is the most extraordinary book I've read this year.
Oh, thank you so much.
I said to you, one of your characters is definitely a Lady Macbeth. But let's talk about Noah, because you begin with her saying her name and the story. Will you read that paragraph for
us? Absolutely, I'd be happy to. My name is Noah P. Singleton. I am 35 years old, and I reside in the Pennsylvania Institute for Women. My identification number is 10271978. I'm the only child of Miss Teenage California 1970 and a week-long sperm donor whose name my mother claimed she couldn't recall. I was salutatorian for my high school, where I ran varsity track and wrote for the school newspaper, investigating the illicit and often extensive use of sale and drugs on campus. I studied biochemistry and engineering at the University of Pennsylvania and have worked as a restaurant hostess, roller rink waitress, substitute teacher, math tutor, and laboratory research assistant. I can recall with faint hyperbole the moment I took my first steps. I've had one serious boyfriend. The trial that led me to you lasted only 5 days, though the jury deliberated for another four. It took only a handful of additional jury pools to select the 12 individuals who were to sentence me to death 5 short months following my trial. Their names are now embossed in my memory, along with my grandmother's scent, mothballs and jewelry cleaner, my first boyfriend's habitual post-coital cigarette, and the feeling of the Latin letters from my high school diploma raised against my thumb.
Thank you.
Thank you.
How long did it take you to write that paragraph?
Oh, that paragraph. Oh, that's a great question. I wrote that whole first, the prologue, the whole first passage, which is about 3 pages, in a matter, the first draft of it, in one day.
Yeah.
It was actually the first bit that I wrote of the entire novel.
Uh-huh.
That I came home immediately after going to an event. When the entire idea for the novel just popped into my head, and I had to understand her. I had to learn her voice.
Yeah.
And so I wanted to get to know her, and that's what came out.
When you say it popped into your, what caused it to pop in your mind?
It came at the end of probably a 4 to 5 month period in which it was my last semester of law school in Austin, Texas. And I had taken a class on capital punishment, which included a clinical. And so that clinical included a visit to death row and meetings with inmates, and I worked directly on a clemency petition. And so I had spent 4 months or so learning all about the law, learning about its evolution and its current status.
Yeah.
And then at the end of that, there was a symposium at the Texas State Capitol where I went, and there were all sorts of individuals who were discussing one potentially wrongful execution. Big firm lawyers, small firm lawyers, journalists, documentary filmmakers, and a priest, and then one victim's right advocate. And so in an instant, actually, I knew that I wanted to explore the kind of polarizing aspects of the death penalty through the eyes of an admittedly guilty inmate and a mourning parent trying to forgive. And so Noah's voice and her victim's mother's voice actually came. They rose around the same time, but I knew that I wanted her to at least introduce herself as somebody who was guilty.
But is she guilty? I mean, that's the whole, and the fact she won't, well, you begin it with by saying the daughter of Miss Teenage California winner. You've said what her life was growing and a sperm donor. Right there, it's like a painting. You can see what this girl, how she was brought up.
I find that little details like that are able to do that, and I love that description of a painting, of the, yeah. the strokes that go into a painting that can help you together, you know, take a yeah. step back and visualize almost, in some sense, almost like a Seurat painting in little dots, actually. Yeah. And then, and if you just put together details of someone's life, you learn who they are, what their parents did, yeah. what GPA they had, what yeah. course they took when they were in 7th grade, in 9th grade, and all of these things together define a life, define yeah. a childhood, which in so many senses can actually give you a window into what the future could be.
And the memory she has of her mother when her mother had dropped her and couldn't really tolerate being guilty, so she destroys the apartment, calls the police. And what that did in Noah's mind, because everything plays back on that incident.
Absolutely. I think that it's, you know, we know this consciously, but it sometimes escapes us as we grow up and as we meet other peoples, yeah. how these incidents that happen to us when we're young completely define us.
Yeah.
Whether it's something positive, whether it's something negative, and that was something that I was fascinated by. I was fascinated by some incidents in our lives that can take hold of us and ultimately control us in ways that we have no concept of how they'll do so. And to start off with just actions and also in terms of guilt.
Yeah. Describe a little bit about the mother making that scene when she called the police, living here in California, and how it really was like imprinted on Noah's mind.
Well, I think, you know, Noah's mother was this failed actress or this attempted, you know,
yeah.
actress. And in Los Angeles, there's so many people like this who, you know, it's, you know, although the novel's not set in Los Angeles, there's this idea of lost dreams. And I think that Noah's mother's somewhat defined by that, this idea of lost dreams and also who am I? And if
yeah.
you haven't actually grasped what that role is, then you don't know what to hang on to. And I think in some senses, Noah has done that as well. She's trying to define herself by something, but it's always by these external forces,
mm-hmm.
whether it's a friend, whether it's a boyfriend, whether it's her mother and her mother's actions.
Yeah.
So this kind of destruction of the house at a very young age, in some senses, can also, maybe it's a destruction of her life, what her life could yeah. be, what it could have been.
Her mother is what I would call a summer stock actress. You know,
yeah.
there are people who live by that one minute they have a big part in a play.
Mm-hmm.
And it ends up, she goes off with the paramedic, number one, who because she kept replacing the men in her life. And this is something Noah sees. But when Noah was 12, she had a good friend, Persephone.
Yes.
And when Persephone, playing around with the grandmother's gun she had given to her parents, shoots, there are no bullets in it. Ha ha, there are bullets. And she is killed. And unfortunately, Noah is there. What do I do? Well, she remembered how her mother, when she was a child, tore up the house and blamed it on the poor unsuspecting person who never came, the outsider.
Absolutely. There's this idea of blame and of guilt, and where do you place that?
Yeah.
And her mother never wanted to accept that blame, and I don't think ever does want to accept that blame, and I think that that's a theme that's pervasive in the novel. And it's one that I think Noah has an evolution
yeah.
In terms of accepting blame, accepting responsibility in her own way, certainly.
Well, she didn't when she was 12. She ran out of the house, and later her mother shows her an article in the newspaper that says, oh, somebody robbed the Persephone's family's home. They killed the child and stole.
Right.
Yeah.
And from that point, you know, at an impressionable age, you know, that is an age in which you're impressionable, but at the same time, you are old enough to start making decisions for yourself. And, you know, it varies from state to state what's considered, you know, when you can be tried as an adult. You know, and there's a lot of debate about that right now as well, and that has been, and that I'm sure will continue into the future. But at what point can you be tried as an adult for a crime?
And at that point, she goes back to high school, and she does very well. She's salutarian of her class, and has been accepted at Princeton. And she goes to the University of Pennsylvania.
Yes.
Why'd you choose that?
Well, I chose University of Pennsylvania because it's my alma mater. And I'd never really done that before, necessarily set things or given shout outs, so to speak. But I wanted to set it at Penn because, you know, I thought the city of Philadelphia would be a phenomenal landscape for this story. It's a very urban, it's an urban setting. It's also a very crime ridden city. And it's also the city where I went to university, but I also went to law school in Philadelphia. So I knew the city well. And I wanted her to kind of escape. I mean, she's running far away, whether it's intentional or unintentional or conscious or unconscious, she's going to the opposite coast. She's going to a completely different style of living when you go from Los Angeles to an East Coast city. And there she can try to, either accept her past, she can try to learn who she is, and she also goes there in some senses because she's looking for her father.
Who is there, who has been in and out of jail and is now running a bar. But she becomes pregnant from her last time in Los Angeles with her boyfriend and has a bad abortion, a hysterectomy, and she's now sort of like driftless.
She, and this happens again quite early on. It's kind of, these things happen to her right at that, right at the cusp in which she can start forming, you know, identity and relationships, long-lasting relationships, and she doesn't really have them in her life. So this happens to her, you know, in her first semester of college. And that's a time of great excitement, but also turmoil for so many people.
Everyone,
exactly. That's when you leave home for the first time, usually. That's when
standing on your own two feet. And then to add to it, she meets her father again. But let me say, for people as they're reading it, you have done it where you say a month before, 3 months before D-Day. But that's 10 years later. Because now there is a woman, Madeline. Marlene, who is, she's a top female attorney. She does have a husband, and she has one child, Sarah. And Sarah, I mean, when you talk about fortuitous things, Sarah has met Caleb, who is the father of Noah. And they have, this is an older man having an affair with a girl who could be his daughter. And Marlene says, I will give you $10,000 to Noah, break up that marriage. I want to know about everything going on. Well, she's broke. She's not asked to do anything at that moment. And she finally says yes. And she doesn't even know Sarah at that point.
No, she doesn't know her at that point.
So I, you know, reading it, I couldn't understand, who is Elizabeth Silver that she has seen this side of life?
My mother asked that same question. You know, I don't know that I've necessarily seen that side of life or but I think that what's interesting to me is it's this idea that I think all people have experienced at some point, is the need to feel loved by a parent, the the need to feel connected with somebody else, and solitude and isolation. And I think, you know, like you mentioned, the novel set kind of in these you know, it's broken up into the 6 months that lead up to X Day, her execution day, which is what Noah calls it. And so it's told in flashback as well as in present day conversations with her attorneys in prison. And so it jumps around in time and in perspective.
And also it jumps around between Marlene writing to the dead Sarah what's going on, which in a way is like Henry the Explainer scene, because you're reading it and seeing it from her point of view, knowing what did happen.
Right. Absolutely.
Yeah.
It presents, I wanted to present both sides. I wanted to, through these two voices, present both sides of the death penalty debate, but at the same time, play around with the idea of victimhood and who is the victim and how capital punishment impacts everyone, not just necessarily the victim's family or the inmate's family, but all people involved.
I had a problem with her not defending herself in the first trial, where she is, you know, has been arrested, is standing trial, and is holding back. I still don't think I can comprehend why she wouldn't have tried to defend herself. But it's 10 years later, she has been convicted, she's been condemned, and I get they don't just send you to the death chair. Or nowadays, she says, there are three drinks or shots you're given. As it is, Marlene comes to see her with a young attorney, Oliver, an Englishman who I guess is an intern lawyer at her firm. And Marlene, in the 10 years, according to what she's saying, has started a philanthropy of MAD, Mothers Against Death.
Mad, yes.
Yeah, compassion.
Yes, yes.
Well, I refer to her as Lady Macbeth because nothing she does is with compassion, even when it was her own daughter.
She didn't quite understand how, I think, to be a mother. I don't think she quite grasped what it meant to show compassion, as you said, to connect with other people. She's very driven by career, by success, by status.
Well, she hadn't wanted to have a child.
Yeah. Well, exactly, which puts her in some sort of interesting connection with Noah as well, who's very ambivalent about motherhood. And so I think that Marlene takes a lot longer to accept motherhood and realize that she loves it but doesn't know how to act. She doesn't know how to be a mother. She doesn't know how to show compassion. And I think you know, in some senses, she's probably, for me, one of the most tragic characters in the novel.
Oh,
She lives in this in the prison that she's created, which she'll she might never get out of.
I have to say, there is a ghastly scene where they have invited Caleb, the father of their unborn grandchild, who has been. They know that their daughter Sarah is dead, and they have not avoided him. Now they invite him into their home, and they torture him mentally.
Yeah, they do. I think that's a wonderful description of that scene. That it is essentially it's psychological torture what they do to him, and I think it's questionable. I think he understands it, but during the course of it, it's one of those experiences in which they definitely, I think, are very classist.
They know too much about him.
They know too much about him, and he doesn't quite have the tools to understand what's happening.
Yeah.
What's happening to him, what happened to Noah, what happens to Sarah.
Yeah.
And so he's a tool for them to manipulate, to get what they want or what they think they need.
Yeah. And so they pay him off that he will not go speak for his daughter. I guess there is, after the trial, there's a place where friends or relatives can speak.
The punishment phase of a trial.
Yeah.
Of the trial, right. This was something that I learned about that I was fascinated by. essentially, there's two separate trials, it seems. You know, the first is just about guilt or innocence, and the second, with a capital punishment case or with a death-eligible case, is the punishment or the penalty phase, in which it's essentially a new trial, but you get to bring in so much more. You can bring in all of somebody's past, whether or not it's would have been admissible in that first part. And so you can have what's called victim impact testimony, which is when you bring in the friends, the family members, you try to say there's something in this person's life that's worthy, we should save this person, or the victim's family member saying this person was so important, nothing that that you say will spare it or should spare it.
And Oliver believes that Marlene is going to now go for clemency or for getting the whole program dismissed because there were things that weren't right in the trial. Well, finally, when Marlene, as it's getting closer and closer to D-Day, she fires Oliver, and he has, yes, but I've got this to prove. And she wants no part of it because she has been waiting for this moment for her revenge. Now, as I said to you, I'm not going to tell anybody in the audience what happens because it's the lady or the tiger and the way you have done it.
I think, you know, Oliver, in many senses, I think, is a stand-in for the reader, or can be. I mean, he's, you know, I think, you know, all of the characters in the novel are tortured in some way, imprisoned in some way, emotionally or physically. And Oliver comes in very fresh, very seemingly innocent, and we find out a little bit more about him as the book goes on. But in some senses, you know, when you're a reader, you come to the book and you don't know what's going on, and you want to root for somebody or not. You want to understand the themes. And I think that Oliver does that in many senses. Yeah. And because he's not American, in some senses he's a foreigner. And as a reader coming into a book, in some senses they're foreigners, that they're to a story. And so I think in that sense, he gets to stand in for the reader and try to understand what's happening, just as the reader tries to understand what's happening. Because, you know, I think whether or not this is true, I think people want others to be good.
Yeah.
They want them to do, you know, to do the right thing. And whether they're not the right thing is necessarily the same across the board is a different story. But Oliver certainly sees the positive in people.
And when Noah tells you, the reader, Elizabeth, right? Noah tells you what really happened that New Year's Day. You stop reading and have to think about it. You've done so many scenes here where you stop and you have to think about what is reality, what happened.
Oh, I'm glad to hear that. That's so wonderful to hear. I hope that would happen, that people would think about what happened and also think about what it means to be guilty, which is, you know, the distinctions between moral guilt, legal guilt, psychological guilt.
Elizabeth, did you have an agent? How did you get Crown to buy the book?
I have an absolutely extraordinary agent that I just adore, and so he sold the novel. It was one of the best days of my life.
Yeah, I'm sure. What anything changed when it was sold?
Ah, that's a good question. It was about 5 years from when I started writing it to when it sold, and about 4 years before, you know, until I it sold. I'm sorry, 5 years from publication to the start of writing it, and it was about a year and change of working with my editor and everything. So I worked with my agent for about 6 months. We tweaked it, we edited it, and then he sold it. Then I worked with this wonderful, wonderful editor at Crown.
What was changed?
What was changed? Well, I certainly developed the character of Caleb, Noah's father, in much greater detail than I had prior to selling it. His character was fleshed out substantially more. Mm-hmm. The writing, and the themes and the characters were certainly intact. But I, you know, I cleaned up some plot changes here and there, and and it was a lot of little kind of plot clarifications.
Did the writing of Marlene to the Dead Sarah help as you were writing it?
I don't know that it helped or hindered. I think it was part of the story for me.
It was part of the
voice that I had to tell this story. The story couldn't be told without Marlene's voice.
Yeah.
And it couldn't be told without Noah's voice. But but for me, this is a story about the relationship between these two women and how their roles become foggy. And so having that divide throughout each of the months,
mm-hmm.
I think helped certainly ground the novel.
And it also allowed you not to get stuck with minutiae.
Yes.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
I love the book, Elizabeth.
Thank you.
And much good luck with it. Will you autograph my book?
It would be an honor. Thank you.
Thank you. And I hope there's another book coming out soon.
Oh.
Sooner than 5 years.
I hope so too. Thank you.
And if you'd like to know what else we've been reading, visit me on the web at www.conniemartinson.com or visit us at YouTube at Connie Martinson's channel. This show will be on in within a few weeks, but there are other shows in the past you may want to look up. Robert Tannenbaum, the other, Marissa Silver. And whatever you do, though, support your local library. Libraries at this moment, they are having funds that have been cut. Volunteer your time. Bring a child with you. Get them their library card. Again, volunteer to read to children. And even for yourself, if you have a problem reading, libraries all over America are helping people with larger print books, as well as helping them to learn to read better. Most important factor in life, knowing how to read. Well, surprise, and thank your librarian. And we'll see you next time. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.